Welcome to Prime Venture Partners Podcast, a podcast for entrepreneurs looking to build and grow their startups. Learn about uncommon strategies and common traps from makers and doers of startup ecosystem.
Hi, everybody. This is Sanjay Swamy, Managing Partner at Prime Venture Partners. Welcome to our podcast series. Prime, as you know, is an early stage venture capital fund investing in technology and product fit focused businesses. Today, we have with us Vyas Nambisan, CEO of one of our first companies in the portfolio, EasyTap, which is fairly well known now as a mobile-based payments acceptance solution and doing a lot more now. Company is now in about 7 years old, has several hundred thousand points where it's being used by a number of large enterprises. And Vyas joined the company about 5 years ago, initially as the CFO, and has now taken over as the CEO as both the founders have moved on. So Vyas, this is sort of a unique situation that we have here, and would love to share your experiences of the journey as well. So tell us a little bit about your background and what brought you to EasyTap.
Sure. Before I started at EasyTap, I spent 20 years at Intel. Thought I would be a lifetime Intel big company employee. And I had happened to meet Bobby in one of my stints with Intel when I was at India as CFO of Intel India. We had gone back to California and I was there. I had been 4 years in my role in California and I was looking at my next assignment within Intel. We started thinking about, what are the different things we could talk, I could consider doing. And I got talking to Bobby and he was saying, hey, why don't you think about startups? Why don't you come and look at companies here? Come look at us. I'll introduce you to others. So I made a trip out to India, met the team. I liked the area that we're working on. I didn't know much about fintech, the tech part, but not the fin part. But it seemed like it was dynamic, it was changing, it was interesting. I liked the team. Both those things were important to me. I got to gel with the team, got to be interested in the company. Decided to go ahead and take the plunge. And so joined them in 2014. I was with Bobby for 4-something years. When the founders leave the company, it is a big change. Because a lot of the culture of a company revolves around the tone set by the founders. So therefore, when there's a change from a founding leadership, I would imagine most companies, it is hard. I think we had the benefit that I had worked for 4 years with Bobby. We actually shared a similar background, similar approach. Over the 4 years, it was sort of our joint culture that already existed. So for me, there was a sense of continuity going forward that perhaps somebody coming from outside may not have had the benefit of. Still, I think it's a big change, even for the employees and the team. There's uncertainty, and for your customers, etc., there's uncertainty.
So I think in EasyTap's case specifically, there were 3 stakeholders that you had to interact with, and there were, of course, the employees, which were the most important from an immediate perspective, but also business partners as well as customers, right? Yeah. Given that the business involves partnering with the largest of banks and customers are some of the largest names in the industry. So those would be in 3 areas. Were there any specific things that you did for each of these stakeholders?
Absolutely. I think all 3 have to be addressed quickly and firmly. Can't let things linger. So I started with the employees. I got to start with the home base. I started by meeting every single person in the team, in our company, in teams of 5 to 10, walked them through. They knew me, they were comfortable with me, but they were uncomfortable with the change, the magnitude of the change. So I had to walk them not only through the reason why Bobby was leaving and the change, but also energize them with my vision of where I wanted to take them. I think both those elements were important. And I think I was successful in taking the team through. Anytime there's change, it's an opportunity to sort of re-energize, reset, etc. So I really took advantage of that to pump up the energy level, get them focused, get much more focused. And I think that really paid off. The next set was to then, go after the customers and partners and connections. I already knew most of them. Those whom I didn't, I got connected to through Bobby, to you, Sanjay, connected quickly, met them, established a face-to-face relationship, and again, walked through the transition. They had some questions, but at the end, they would say, okay, yeah, comfortable where EasyTap is going, and it was pretty seamless.
And of course, the 4th stakeholder there being the investors and the board, but there you had the continuity and you had the full backing.
So that's right.
So just for the audience, actually, the board conducted a CEO search and actually worked with the recruitment firm and actually made sure that we did the right thing fiduciary-wise. And then after that period of time, during which Piaz was an interim CEO, he did such a special job that we felt he really is the right person for the role. And it's worked out really well. I think it's very clear from, you know, the social media and all the other posts that I see. And yesterday, I judged Hackathon at EasyTap as well, that the energy is, you know, gone to a new level. So as he said, whenever there's a change, there's an opportunity to inject some new direction. But broadly, Bias, from your perspective, you know, while some of the methods might have changed, and, you know, the energy levels have, you know, perhaps changed and gone up because just that was an opportunity to do so. I think a lot of what you also did has started producing some, you know, new results from a strategic direction perspective, right? And that's where the continuity and the thought process help. But it's also, you know, quite dangerous in some ways to do these things sort of aggressively and abruptly, right? So how do you manage sort of keeping with the same strategy and yet sort of expanding on it and perhaps accelerating some of the broader growth plans that the company may have had? And how do you change as these moments, you know, or inflection points?
Look, there's always change. There's constant change. And trying to figure out how we respond either proactively or reactively, depending on where we are to the change, is key. Look, I'm not afraid to fail. I'm afraid to do nothing. So I'd rather think about ways to attack something and then go about it. And if failure happens, it happens. That's, and you learn and then you figure out how to move forward. In setting the strategy, choosing a course of action, one of the things I did with the leadership of my team was to get them really bought in and leverage the collective wisdom versus just my thoughts on where we should go. I think by getting that, I've got the buy-in from the team. And that actually gives me stability because at any point, there are people who are reinforcing you and supporting your strategy within your team. And it's not just you propping up a strategy. It is much more powerful. And so we were able to achieve that, get the consensus, if not consensus across everybody, but across enough of a majority. So I had buy-in from the leadership team to take the company in the direction forward. And that helps sustain it because it's the team that's interacting with everyone else in the company. And they have to be the ones reinforcing our direction, reinforcing the strategy. I've got their buy-in. Then I've got that continuity going and ability to make some tough decisions and make our way through some, you know, wrong turns and where we have to make corrections.
So you moved from a role of CFO, which sort of was really more of a COO role, practically speaking, during the latter part of the first 4 years, and in a tech product company. And of course, you've been at Intel for several years, but also mostly in finance roles. What was the fundamental change of, you know, moving from managing the expenses and, you know, the business plan to all of a sudden saying we need to spend money, we need to do this, we need to do that, right? And how did you handle that?
You know, there's the biggest change for me was with Bobby and me, it was like captain and co-pilot, right? We did many of the similar things, but there was an opportunity to always bounce off of each other and, if you will, debate with each other on decisions and go forward. And that's one of the things that was hardest for me as I, you know, went forward. You know, the initial part is I didn't have that one single point. Now, I did have a team, but I didn't have the equivalent of that pilot, co-pilot relationship. And so often a lot of the decisions now are just me versus, you know, Bobby and me bouncing it off of each other. That was the hardest transition really for me to make. The other hard transition for me to make was putting on much more of the sales outgoing hat, sort of being the inward execution, growing that side skill was also a change for me. It's a continued learning experience. I think it doesn't matter. You know, to me at 2014, you know, we were still in the nascent stages of ramping the business and growing the business. And I'd been with the business long enough that to me, I feel no different. I don't think the company feels any differently about me either. So that hasn't been much of an issue.
I'm going to go a little off topic here and talk about something that you do that to me actually was one of the things that contributed a lot to my confidence that you'd be an amazing CEO. And it's actually what you do in your garage. So not many people know about this, and I'll tell you later what he's called by the neighbors. But Bias, tell us about, you know, what you really are passionate about.
You know, my real passion is about restoring cars. So I build cars, I restore them all by myself. I do build engine, I build suspension, I'll do brakes, upholstery, paint, everything in my garage by myself. And I've always loved doing that. I loved doing this as a kid. Had the opportunity while in the US to go to a junkyard, buy old beat up cars, restore them, and figuring out how to restore it back to factory perfection to me was it's my stress reliever and my passion. Always loved it, and I do it. And, you know, I'll jump on with Sanjay alluded to. So one day a delivery guy came to our house. I was coming and I called him and I asked him, where are you? He's inside. He said, sir, I'm in front of Mechanic Wallah's house. Where's your house? So apparently the security guys and all the local staff in Palm Meadows called me Mechanic Wallah.
But, you know, I think that's the passion for product, right? And I think that carries through. And one of the things Bias has done, so in the early days, EasyTap used to make our own devices, although now the company is purely a software company and doing, you know, enterprise-wide payment acceptance. And so we had bought a 3D printer to test some of the prototypes. And one weekend I was in HSR, I walked into the office and here was Bias printing a part for his carburetor, for his car. You know, I need to replace something. So he actually has a 3D printed part in his car.
One of the things that working on cars taught me two things. Right? One is when you start working on old cars, you say, okay, you know, your car is at stage X. You say, I want it to go straight up to stage Y where it's perfect. And you draw a straight line between that and say, okay, I'm going to start working on it and it's going to go up towards that stage of perfection. When you start working on a uncover that reality is it's not a straight line. You actually start going down first. Car actually sort of gets worse because as you pull it apart, you realize there's more things wrong or things that you thought you could be an easy fix actually take longer. And you have to stay persistent with it. You have to have the belief that you can still pull it out and go through. So that persistence that drives you up and towards getting it correct and done. And to me, that's a life lesson that to me translates into work as well. I figure through, yes, there's going to be problems, but now I have confidence that, you know, I'm going to stick with it. I'll see that turnaround. I'll see that move up because I've done it so many times in the car world. And I have the confidence of, okay, that's, you know, you have to deal with it. It will happen. And you've got to learn how to power through that. The other thing you learn is when you're doing this, you need to have attention to detail. You got to think about all the possible consequences of how things come together and fit together. What's your budget? What's all of that? And what's your objective? Where are you getting to? You got to think through that. Otherwise, you're going to spend a lot of money and get an unsatisfactory result. Again, something that translates, even in our business and products, I get involved into. Hey, how does this walk me through exactly how does it work? Asking all the right questions.
So EasyTap has evolved its business, its target markets, focus areas, solutions over the years. And now that you've been 1 year, you know, as CEO of the company, I think congratulations, just about your first anniversary week. How do you describe EasyTap now and what's the next 2 years hold in store?
We're a payment platform company that has, I want to say, a powerful platform, flexible modular platform, both for enterprise solutions, but also for merchant solutions. And I think the growth is our ability to be a fast modular platform is going to allow us to drive and innovate in areas which are rapidly changing and drive that innovation and grow the company. Payments itself is a small piece. There's lots of things around payments that are equally important, whether it's reconciliations, value-added services, etc. And our ability to deliver all of these pieces will be key in delivering our growth over the next 2 years.
Bias, always a pleasure to chat with you. People may not know, Bias and I actually went to the same school together. He's a few years junior to me. We didn't really know each other then. Then, of course, he corrupted himself by going to the number one competitor school of ours. But it's great to have a fellow Josephite on the show. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Sanjay.
And all the best at EasyTap.
Always great talking to you. Thanks.
Thank you.
Listeners, thank you for listening to this episode of the podcast. Subscribe now on your favorite podcast app for free, and you'll be the first one to know when new episodes are available. Just search for Prime Venture Partners Podcast in Apple Podcast, Spotify, Castbox, or however you get your podcasts. Then hit subscribe. And if you have enjoyed the show, we would be really grateful if you leave us a review on Apple Podcast. To read the full transcript, find the link in the show notes.